Over now.
Okay, sir.
Please sit down, ma. Now, do you think polio is eradicated by vaccination? That's what the statistics tell you. 27,000 children are now suffering from what is called non-polio acute paralytic illness. Those who have got polio vaccination, the poor children. Do you know why? This polio vaccination, oral vaccination, even according to our textbooks, is prevented from being given to poor children, because without protein in the body, this doesn't produce antibodies. On the contrary, the live virus that you're given in the mouth goes through the gut and converts into P2, P3, the real dangerous polio virus, and produces a paralytic illness. And we still have the illness, but we have not named it different, that's all. For political reasons, the name is changed. So the name now is not polio, it's called acute paralytic non-polio paralysis. Please read about that, ma, number one. Number two, tuberculosis, you think, is gone because of tuberculosis searching program. You know, in 1956, Government of India invited one of the greatest tuberculosis specialists in the world called J.R. Bignall. John Bignall was the professor of respiratory disease in London. In 56, he came, Nehru gave him a helicopter, he went around the whole country and said, look, Mr. Prime Minister, you have about 5 lakhs TB patients in India. Please don't get the drugs now not supplied very well. Don't give them drugs, give them good food and good ventilation and good treatment. Half of them will get cured, and they, with them the germ will die. The other half will die. With them the germ will die. So at the end of 5 years, India will be rid of tuberculosis. Do you know what Nehru said? This white man wants Indians to die. So Nehru allowed the drugs to come. He believed, like you, that drug comes, it goes. Drug came, drug came, drug came. Today, all over the world, we have such a huge load of tuberculosis, which is called white death. In America, every doctor, every nurse is being given anti-tubercular treatment before going to the hospital, because you can be tuberculosis. There's a resurgence of tuberculosis all over, because you can't kill the germ with a drug, man. It's not a proposition at all. Tuberculosis germ was not even a germ which was killing man. It is a soil germ. Because we became very sophisticated, we started plowing digging the thing, the germ got airborne. Now we got human tuberculosis, bovine tuberculosis, avian tuberculosis. Tuberculosis has not gone, it has come back with a bang. Now all these dot, geet, this, that, survey, give, is all behind that. There is a big business. If you want to know how big this business is, you must know a little more about drug companies. Write down. The Truth About Drug Companies is a book written by the former editor of the New England Journal of Medicine, a woman like you, a committed professor like you, in Johns Hopkins Hospital. Her name is Marcia Angell. And Marcia writes this beautiful book called Truth About Drug Companies. Side heading is How They Cheat the World and What to Do About It. Marcia Angell, Harper Collins, $17. Please read the book. Okay? Now that's about it. Now coming to your screening business. Big article. The screening industry. Write down. Author's name is Richard Smith, the editor of the British Medical Journal. In the British Medical Journal. So go to internet and say Richard Smith, the screening industry, and you will read everything. But there are two exceptions. If you are a heavy smoker, if you are a heavy alcoholic, your body's message to you will be lost. So you must have a regular checkup if you don't stop your smoking and if you don't stop drinking. Now you asked a very pertinent question. Cancer screening. Okay? You said, I have seen cervical cancer patients, advanced stage. I could catch them young. When is that young? That cervical cancer started as a mutated cell 25 years ago. You have to catch it, remove her uterus and the ovaries also. At this rate, by another 10 years, Angelina Jolie will be left with only probably head or leg. So, madam, this is all industry business, ma. You see, because I wish you asked another question. Can't we treat it young? Studies have shown that in the asymptomatic stage, if any give treatment, that's of no use. It only kills the patient faster. It applies to hypertension, diabetes, etc., etc. These are all lifestyle diseases. Do you know why you get hypertension and diabetes? Because of stress. What is the stress? See, we were hunter-gatherers in the forest thousands of years ago. And that time, Tiger used to come to kill you, so you had to run away from the tiger. God gave you an autonomic nervous system. As a doctor, you understand that. So when you see the tiger, you want to run. And to run, you require sugar, you require blood pressure to go up, you require heart rate to go up, and God gave you the adrenaline. Today, the same system is there in you, the autonomic nervous system. It's not changed. You are not seeing a tiger, but you are seeing human tigers now. Your husband may be a tiger, your wife may be a tiger, your boss may be a tiger, your colleague may be a tiger, your student may be a tiger. And when you see this tiger, your blood pressure goes up, your sugar goes up, your cholesterol goes up. But you can't run away from the tiger. The forest tiger, you run away, these all come down. Here you sit and suffer, and it goes up and remains up. Did you get that? Now we doctors tell our patients foolishly, I will give you this chemical, it will all come down. What will come down? Report will come down, not the body. So if you want a good report, take the drugs meticulously. But if you don't want a good report, you can take it easy. You know, I'll tell you this, of course, one sparrow doesn't make a summer. I've had many patients, but one patient is very nice. This man was a diabetic, very severe diabetic. But he was hard-working young man. He lived up to 89, and he used to come to me. He has to come from a place called Manjeshwara, which is about, it's about quite a distance from Mangalore. And to the railway station, he has to walk 10 miles in the morning. So he'll have a big ganji uta and then walk to the railway station. Then he'll catch the train, come to Mangalore. And in Mangalore, he had Arakanat business. So he'll walk to the Bandar, another for 10 miles. And then after all that, he will go and have a sumptuous lunch. If there is payasam, he'll have about 3-4 courses of that. And then he'll take his blood sugar and come to me. When I examine him, he's absolutely fit. So I pat him on the back and say, you are fine, Mr. Chauta. You are nothing to worry about. He says, I have been following everything that you said correctly. So I said, you're not eating anything? No, I'm not eating at all. No, I don't eat. Then while going out, he will say, I have brought my blood report. He'll take it out, put it on my table and run away because it's 600 milligrams. But he didn't die. So initially for about 40 years, I used to tell his children, his children are all big people. One man is here. He was Kalakshetra chairman and all. I used to tell them, you must be very strict with your father and all. Then afterwards I said, look, leave the old man alone. He wants to enjoy life. He was eating payasam, he was eating sugar, he was eating everything that he wanted. Lived up to 89, one fine morning, instead of getting up and going to the railway station, he went to meet his maker in heaven. Don't you think that's a good one? Okay.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes, hello. Sir.
Can I have a question?
Doctor, one second. When consciousness is throughout the universe, in this existence, and mind plays a major role, why the modern science and the academician and the present science is totally missing, and somebody brings about to expose this consciousness and mind, and no real effort is taken in the side of academic and science? For that, I want your comment, and I want, you are doing the right thing, but we people have to take up this in a bigger way.
What a fascinating question. Max Planck, the father of quantum physics, wrote, I quote, consciousness is fundamental. All else is derived from consciousness. And he said, even matter is derived from consciousness. Consciousness is universal consciousness. That's called the universal mind, which we lay people call as God. And individual consciousness, that's your mind. And your mind is not. Where is the mind? Never mind.